Hey everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Mark.
Live from the Armory Wrestling Show is heard worldwide. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on Blog Talk Radio. But this is an FNX.network plug, which means we're heard from Mobile, Alabama to Melbourne, Australia. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Check us out on FNX.network. What do you say, Laura? Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
What in the hell kind of twilight zone have I stepped into?
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
It's kind of like when the first time you hear Bob Saget comes.
And the lovely Laura.
It's official, y'all. I am the wrestling genius.
Hey everybody, you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is the Bunkhouse Bob, and I'm the greatest wrestling mind of the 21st century. Need to give a shout out. I keep forgetting to do this. Want to give a shout out to Michael Rose, the guy that did the music for our intro. If you guys are interested in finding out a little bit about Michael Rose, check him out on Twitter at Captain Hook, and that's at CPTHook74, or go to hook74.com. If you're not familiar with Michael's story and how he plays guitar, you need to get involved with that. Hell of a story. Thanks again, Michael. Appreciate it. Folks, again, this is Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. We thank you very much for tuning in tonight, wherever you're listening at, however you're listening to the program. If you listen and we do this live on Blog Talk Radio or on any other major podcast platform, we certainly appreciate your support. Right, first and foremost, I do have to tell you this because I've gotten a couple of messages about this. People have asked me, said, man, I've tried to go over to FNX.network to listen to the show like I do every week. And lo and behold, I get an error. It says 404 file not found, 404 error, whatever it is. The FNX network is currently moving, actually switching over servers and hosts, I believe. I'm not too familiar with all that technical jargon. When we start getting into big platforms, big server stuff, that's all on that side with FNX Network. They're currently feverently working on getting all that information transferred over and getting the site back up. I spoke with Ryan last night, and he assures me that Kane is doing his top-notch best to get it done. And the only thing I can tell you is, Ryan, if Kane doesn't get it done, I think that Laura and I are just going to take this show and we're going to leave and go to Westwood One. How about that? So get it fixed. That's it. We would encourage you folks to go to www.prowrestlingtees.com. When you're over there, type FNX Network up in the search bar. Buy a shirt. Help support the show. You can do that. Other than doing what you're doing now and listening to the program, make sure that you do that. And if you have a question, a comment, a critique, or a criticism about a guest or a commentary that you've heard on this program, you can always hit us up on email. You can get us at asktheArmory@gmail.com. And before we get any deeper in this, I want to tell you tonight, and this is another thing that we've got to be transparent about, because I'm sure we'll get a couple of phone calls. We always get a couple of phone calls during this month, especially Women's Wrestling Month 2019. Our guest tonight at 7:30 will be Viva Van from Los Angeles, and I have to tell everybody up front, we pre-recorded the interview because Viva could not be with us tonight. The interview's pre-recorded. So if you're going to call in and or tweet a question, whatever, she's not actually live with us in the studio tonight. It's a pre-recorded interview, but nonetheless, I think you're going to get a lot out of it. She's pretty cool lady, and we'll get to that in a few minutes. But another pretty cool lady that I'm going to bring on the program, coming in hotter and faster than Vince McMahon pulling Kurt Angle from his WrestleKate appearance, is the lovely Laura.
What's up, Cuddy?
What are you doing?
Channeling my inner white mic.
Your inner white mic.
Mm-hmm.
How does that feel to channel your inner white mic? How's that feel?
Dirty.
To you. Yeah. I was going to say dirty. Hey, you know, it's you know, it's pretty cool. Want to give a shout out to Timmy and to White Mike for the really cool post that they put up about you and I. That was it was a comment. It was a comment and a reply and a back and forth, and really, really cool of the Gymnasty Boys, Timmy Lou Retton, White Mike. If you're not familiar with them, you probably live under a rock and don't like wrestling anyway, so it doesn't matter. Very, very nice of them to give out that shout out. Two really nice guys.
I have a story about that and how all that came about from the AML show that John and I attended on Sunday.
Okay.
So we can get into that here in a little bit.
Okay.
But I think it's time to talk about social media.
Let's do it.
You can tweet along with George 123 Kid Cole. How do you like about that?
Yeah, 123 Kid Cole.
Yeah, the 123 Kid Cole. And from tonight, he's on the Twitter. You can also tweet along with me, Bob, George, and our good friend Dr. Goozletron, respectively, at Circle Sky, at Bob underscore Delph, at Heel Heat, at The Gray Lobster. You can find us on Facebook. We have an official page and a fan page. You can find us on YouTube by searching in their search bar, Live from the Armory. Every show from the past 3 years is up on the YouTube. So when you're out making town, give us a listen. Because we've got tons of people. We've got a plethora. You know what a plethora is?
Yeah, a lot.
Okay. Do you know what movie that's from?
No.
Three Amigos.
Okay.
So, with that being said, that's all our socials, and I would like to get to some things that, you know, we always talk about our week, and I would just like to say that John and I ran into Zane Riley last night at the Charlotte Knights game, and congratulated him on his Chikara debut. I don't know if a lot of people know this, but that's where Zane's been wanting to be for a very long time, is in Chikara. So he made his debut over the weekend, and I didn't get to talk to him very long, but I talked to Billy Brash at the AML show about Zane's debut, and he's some kind of a monster. I haven't seen it. I mean, that's his name, something monster. I haven't seen it, like, on video or whatever. But,
right. I was going to ask you what his character was going to be, because for people that don't know, their Chikara is very character-heavy. Yeah, very gimmick-heavy, so, yeah.
He joked and was like, you know, everybody loved it but Xbox. So, seeing Zane night baseball game, and I will share this with you because I've talked about my experience with meeting Ric Flair on this show a lot, because it's Ric Flair. It wasn't that great. So with that being said, meeting Andrew Jones was not that great.
Okay.
Which was
a
real.
Well, that's where I want to pause you at. I'm not familiar with this person, and
okay.
You can
let me explain,
call me dumb or whatever, but yeah, who is this guy that you guys went to see?
I would never call you dumb for that reason. I'll call you dumb for a lot of other
reasons. Yeah.
Andrew Jones was a star baseball player for the Atlanta Braves in the 2000s.
Okay.
Multiple time all-star, just a really great all-around baseball player. And when my grandfather went to Atlanta in 2003, we were on TV, and they sent him to Atlanta. He got to sit in the dugout, and there was a picture that was taken of my grandfather between Andrew Jones and Rafael Furtado, who was the shortstop for the Braves at the time, another phenomenal player.
Okay.
So I got Andrew to sign that photo. I got it enlarged. Walked up to him. I was like, hello, Andrew. You know, it's a pleasure to meet you. Yeah. Just signed it, went on. We were not even allowed to take a picture with him because the line was so long.
Yeah.
And I felt so horrible about it because I couldn't even get my phone loaded up in time to take a picture of John just talking to him. That's how fast they were moving us through that line.
Wow.
And I get it.
There's
a ton of people, but there were a lot of people complaining. A lot of people, because that guy is huge to Atlanta fans.
Sure. Absolutely. Okay.
And we talked to one of the guys, like the one of the ushers, and he was like, I'm glad to see y'all smiling. Did you get to meet Andrew? Because we had our Braves attire on, and Charlotte is a White Sox farm team affiliate. So they knew that we were not there to see, you know, the Charlotte Knights, which they have a decent team. He was like, yeah, I'm glad to see you smiling. I've seen a lot of people leave out of here not smiling, and I'm thinking, I probably know why, you know?
Here's your clue. Here's your clue.
Right.
Yeah.
Because
that's,
it was ridiculous.
Yeah.
But, you know,
I saw something like that with Mick Foley once. Mick Foley did a signing at the Columbus Clippers ball stadium, the old ball stadium in Columbus. And at that time, Columbus was the farm team affiliate for the New York Yankees. And the WWE was coming into town. I can't remember if it was for that Monday night. It was a weekend game, weekend baseball game. And Mick had three or four WWE handlers. I would even say this might, it was WWE. It wasn't WWF. Had three or four handlers with him. And the line wrapped around the concourse, right? You know, I mean, how it, you know, it's, you know how it goes, because he was signing, I don't know, somewhere off like the first base entrance. We'll put it that way. It wrapped all the way around to the third base entrance. Okay.
Surprising.
Yeah, I mean, from here to Terre Haute and back, right? He was signing stuff so fast. You know, people were, and it wasn't Mick, because you and I have met Mick separately from this. I've met him two or three times after this, and we'll talk. As long as you are standing there, they were whipping him, them people in and out of there like white on rice. I mean, one after the other, and he had to stop, and you could see him, you know, moving his hands, moving his fingers, trying to get his, you know, his hands going or whatever, as how fast he was signing. I mean, it was one and done, you know, that kind of thing. So I can empathize.
Yeah, I can understand handlers, but I mean, you're not even really talking to people. Hey,
yeah, more of his. Yeah, yeah. Well, you and I both have had that brush off on more than one occasion. That sucks.
You know, whatever. You know, it still didn't taint the memory I have with my grandfather of going to Atlanta and the time that he had, and everyone treated him so well. But yeah, I was just kind of like, dude, I know that this is rough. You know, but hell, if you don't do it, don't come. You know, I mean, you ought to have an idea. You're in Charlotte. You're mighty close to Atlanta.
You know what the expectations are going to be going into that, especially if he doesn't do it that often.
Exactly. He doesn't. Yeah. And, you know, last year, the same day last year, we went to see David Justice, who was another player for Atlanta. He was a totally different person. He was engaged. He was laughing. Now, there wasn't quite as many people. And for clarity, I'll put that up there for full, disclosure. But he was laughing and talking, and I had posted something on Twitter the following day and tagged him in it. And I brought that up to him. He was like, oh, so you're the one that did that. And so, it was just like night and day, night and day. But it was John and I had a good time, spending time together. So that was the most important thing.
Sure.
But it was just kind of like, and I enjoy going to Charlotte. And, I did want to say this. I go to Charlotte frequently, but I'm not that familiar with where things are. So I'm scrolling through Facebook, and I see this thing that says, the University of North Carolina at Charlotte is on lockdown. And I was like, what? And so I'm like, Jonathan, where is UNCC from here? Oh, it's all the way across town. Well, of course, my first reaction was, I'm not going to get political or anything, but, I just think that at some point in this country, it's got to stop. It's got to stop. Something somewhere, and I'm not the one to solve the problem, but it's just got to stop. This is craziness.
Yeah.
For people to go on a college or go anywhere with a gun and just start shooting people. I live 12 miles from Virginia Tech on April 16th, 2007, when 32 people lost their lives. For what?
Yeah.
So, and that's what I'm going to say. It's just, I don't want to sound cliche, thoughts and prayers or whatever, but I do feel, sympathy for the ones that, lost and the ones that, survived it, who are going to have to go through this every day of their life. Just something's got to stop. And that's all I'm going to say is just, it was horrible. It was just horrible.
Yes. Absolutely.
But with that, I just had to say that because, I wasn't there at the campus, but I was in Charlotte and I was just like, holy crap, you kind of get a little scared because you're like, where is that in relation to here? And there's like, how many people here? And this is a busy city. It's not like you can get in and out really quickly.
Right.
But anyway.
Yeah, makes sense. Makes sense.
When moving along, I would like to say that the AM show that John and I went to on Sunday, oh my gosh, it was phenomenal.
Good show.
It was great. And I tell you what, it was great seeing Chip Day.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen Chip Day since God was a boy.
Yeah.
And so he's not lost a step. He's still Chip effing Day. And so Chip effing Day is your new AML Prestige champion because he pinned Scorpio Sky, which, by the way, SoCal Uncensored, three great guys. Met them, talked to them. Told Christopher Daniels, I said, I really enjoyed Curry Man. He said, when I see him, I'll tell him.
That's good. That's good.
But I said, I'm really looking forward to seeing you guys in AEW. And Scorpio said, we're really looking forward to being in AEW.
Yeah.
So three great guys, and it seems like they're going to come back. So, hey, come on back. And they had a great match with the Gym Nasty Boys. So proud of Timmy and White Mike. These two, the first time I saw Mike was at a Grindhouse match, and I knew he had it when I saw him. And I saw Timmy Lou Retton at PWX do a split and got booed the shit out of for it. I mean, oh my God, but just so proud of them. I mean, I just can't say enough to see people who are working toward their dreams to, wrestle with people that's been on a national stage.
Sure.
You know, TNA and Ring of Honor.
Right. Right.
So, you know, just, you know, great, great match. J.B. Cole had a great match with Eric Andrews. That was just absolutely phenomenal. J.B. Cole, he's getting it.
Yeah.
He is
yeah.
getting it. So our good friend, Coach Areno, Josh Gary, ran into him, talked with him for a little bit. We were talking about the Crockett Cup because he was just at the Crockett Cup the night before. And when you're seeing people getting streamers out of the ring, he's one of them.
Okay.
Have you seen the Crockett Cup yet?
I have not had a chance to watch the Crockett Cup.
Oh,
I've been involved with a myriad of other issues here.
And I understand that. I totally get that. I'm just going to say you are going to love this show.
Okay.
I got giddy. I wasn't able to go. I watched it on the Fight app. John got me a little Crockett Cup pin at the show, and he got an NWA shirt. But you're going to love it. It's like 1986.
Yeah, I saw the pictures of the stage set up, and got to give a shout-out to John Moses that did the did the painting on that, on the canvas, and taking care of the ring apron stuff. Absolutely awesome.
Spot on. That was a great show. I won't talk about it since you haven't seen it. Don't want to spoil anything,
right.
But I'll just say this. Ricky Morton still got it, okay?
Yeah.
If you left him, he still got it. Robert takes Stan Lane bumps nowadays, but not Ricky Morton. I'll just say
right.
that. Do you know how good it did my heart to see them two in an NWA ring again? Oh,
yeah.
I just tear up right now thinking about it. It takes me back to being 12 years old and sitting in the Roanoke Civic Center. I can't talk about it. I'm going to tear up. But that was a great show at AML. You know, Tracy and Brian are putting on a wonderful show, some great and phenomenal talent. Even I got some special presents from George South. I'm blessed and beyond lucky to call him a friend. I can't even go into that either. It's going to make me cry. But George told me and John that we were the only two fans in the whole building that got his wrestling joke. He wrestles C.W. Anderson, or is like I like to call him E.C.W. Anderson.
Right.
Great match. That was an old school match. Great. I can't wait to see George with a new AML belt. The Dawsons did the Bulldogs dirty. I'll just go ahead and say it. They did them dirty. And as much as I kept trying to heckle them, and they just wouldn't, because they'd fall out, and I'd be like, this is why you lost at the Crockett Cup.
Oh.
Most told me, but Zane Wood, he'd argue with people. He'd say, you ask Lorelai, and she'll tell you. And I'm like, oh, my God, I don't even know what you just said. So, fun times were had all around. I did not get to say goodbye to Tracy, because we were trying to get out, because Lexington is a bit of a haul for me. But I'd like to thank Brian Hawks. He went back and got Chip Day, so I could say hello to him, because I hadn't seen him in four freaking ever. But good stuff, just some really, really good stuff. Real quick, wanted to mention, I don't know if everyone's seen this or not, but Joey Ryan has mentioned that he's leaving the Indy. You know, he's done with the indies. Has a shirt on ProWrestlingTees.com, cha-ching. But it's interesting, you know, is he retiring? Is he signing with someone? You know, a lot of people are speculating he's signing with AEW, which for a company that hasn't had its first show, I mean, Jesus Christ, and we'll talk about it when Bob talks about well, I guess we're not talking about that. I want to talk about real quick WWE pulling Kurt Angle from WrestleCade, but not from the gathering.
Well, see, I mentioned that at the top of the show. I think that will be, that will come along too. I find it very, very compelling that the WWE is is just, I think that they just feel like they're backed into a corner and they're protecting their best interests. Now, for the fans that wanted to see Kurt at WrestleCade, it absolutely sucks. And I totally get that. From a business standpoint, it makes no sense for the WWE to allow Kurt Angle to appear, because whether, however you want to mix it, however you want to put it, WrestleCade for them is competition. Just like any other promotion is competition. If it's not got the WWE logo on it, it is the competition. So no one in their right mind at WWE corporate, including Vince McMahon, is going to allow Kurt Angle to make an outside appearance, you know, other than, you know, other than being with WWE. It's just not, they're not going to do it.
And it does make sense. I get that. You know, I read some articles where, you know, Brian was like, it's because we're affiliated with AEW. Now, if they don't pull him at the gathering, then that's it.
Mm-hmm. It could be. That's possible. That's possible.
Just throw that out there, because for some a promotion that's not even put on a damn show yet,
yeah.
Jesus, dancing Christ.
Well, there's two things. There's two things I want you to tell me. The first one is I want you to tell me the AML story with Mike and Tim. And then the second thing I want you to do is I want to go on and get the Twitter poll done. Because Mr. Coles will be crying like a baby after we get off air.
I'm so sorry, George. Hand me a tissue because I got an issue cold.
Yes.
So real quick, I posted on Facebook about how proud I was of Timmy and Mike. And, you know, Mike had posted, had commented on it, like, thanking me and Bob, basically, for always supporting them. And you know, I like to support Timmy and Mike because they're two of the good ones.
Yeah.
They've always been very open. Every time I see them at a show, I get a hug. Timmy, as a matter of fact, they weren't even booked at WrestleCade last year, and they were on their way somewhere else, and he hugged me and just kept going. But yeah, I mean, it's wonderful when wrestlers get what we do and are appreciative of what we do. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. The acknowledgement, the acknowledgement is nice. What's nicer for me personally is kind of like what you said, they are two tremendous individuals. And I can remember the first time that I met Tim, and I very, very vividly remember the first time that I met Mike, and I've shared this on the show, standing outside of the Benton Convention Center, and Mike and I talking, and, you know, him, you know, talking about, you know, some matches. We were talking about some few things, and, you know, I said, one day you're going to be in here. You know that, right? And he said, I know. And I said, no, I'm serious. I said, just keep at it. Just keep at it. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep moving forward. Don't listen to the doubt. Don't listen to the self-doubt. Don't listen to those that tell you that you can't, because you can. And, you know, I remember that, and you know, and it's cool to see them doing the things and reaching the goals that they have set for. So, you know, Tim and Mike will always have a special place for me, you know, in my heart. Just two stand-up guys. Love them to death. Love them to death.
You can't go wrong with Timmy and White Mike. And let me get the Twitter poll up here, because I don't have it up here.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. But I want to talk about this whole Dean Ambrose thing. And I want to tell you, when we get to it, I want to tell you what my theory is on that.
Okay.
Because I have a theory.
I'm sure that you do. I've got a theory, too. But we'll see if they marry up. How about that?
In honor of Avengers Endgame, which I've not seen yet, and if somebody tells me any more spoilers than what they have, I'm going to cut their tongues out. What do you consider the greatest wrestling faction? Our choices are the Four Horsemen, the NWO, Degeneration X, and the Bullet Club.
Okay.
Which I'm really, very happy as to who won.
Right.
The Four Horsemen win with 52% of the vote because I really thought the Bullet Club was going to win. NWO got 19%.
Uh-huh.
Degeneration got 11%. And the Bullet Club tied with the New World Order, for all you people who didn't know what the NWO stood for, at 19%. So I'm like, wow, that's, But the Horsemen are the greatest. And if anybody says otherwise, they're lying.
I'm surprised that George didn't put the Aces and Eights in there either, just for shits and giggles. I mean, if you look at each one of those factions, the Bullet Club, I think is just a play on the foundation that the Horsemen laid out for all of those other factions that were mentioned. Degeneration X, after a certain period of time, the childlike behavior and immaturity overrode the talent. Was some of it funny? Sure it was. And then there was other parts that was just, the attitude era. You take it for what it was. The NWO was awesome, especially, when you had the Hulk Hogan heel turn. And then all of a sudden, 3/4 of the roster was in the NWO and it just got watered down. And obviously, the winner of the poll this week, hands down is the Four Horsemen. And I'm not talking about the incarnation with Paul Roma in it either. The Four Horsemen set the template for the modern day wrestling faction. They were four athletes that guys either wanted to be, they loved them or hated them. Women wanted to be with, beat all the gold. And they lived the gimmick. That was probably the biggest thing for me is that, they spoke about excellence inside and outside of the ring, and they exuded excellence inside and outside of the ring. But we're also talking about at a time when, we didn't have the internet and you didn't know that, they had went to college together or, they had been buddies, outside of the ring and all that other stuff. You know what I mean?
Right. And I mean, I was not a Horseman fan growing up, but they're it. I mean, nothing came close to what they did. Dusty couldn't even get a stable of baby faces together.
Right. Right. Yeah. It was always a mishmash and, they were a cohesive unit,
They sure were. And, you love to hate them. That's what you were supposed to do.
Yeah.
But for me, it's hands down, it's the Horsemen.
Yep. Always will be. Always will be. Well, folks, we're going to go on and get to that portion of the show because, after all, this is Women's Wrestling Month 2019, and a lot of people have asked us why we would continue with Women's Wrestling Month, and in the interview, it kind of explains why, but to give you a little bit of a heads up, I mean, everybody knows what we've had go on in women's wrestling over the last two and a half years, but it wasn't that long ago that women's wrestling was an afterthought. It was a bathroom break. It was let's go to the concession stand, and all that. And it's not that anymore. And when we first launched the show, we were like that there has to be more emphasis on women's wrestling because there's some tremendously talented women that are on the independent circuit that nobody's paying attention to. And thus Women's Wrestling Month was born. And this year we decided to reach out to someone on the West Coast. We haven't been out on the West Coast in a while. And, we're really, really, really glad that we were able to reach out to this person. And without any more from me, we'll go on and run our Viva Van interview. We hope you enjoy it. Ladies and gentlemen, we're really excited to have this lady on the program. As you know, this is the kickoff for us for our annual Women's Wrestling Month 2019. We've been doing this for a few years, and everybody's like, you know, why are you doing Women's Wrestling Month when women's wrestling has pretty much taken over? Well, we still keep that tradition. We still pay homage to that. That's important because we've been doing this, like I said, for a couple years. And what's really cool about this is that we're going back to the West Coast. We haven't been to the West Coast in a while. And joining us tonight, really excited to have this lady on. Some will call her Vivian Van, some or Viva Van. Some will call her the Hellbent Vixen. But what we would like to call her is multi-talented. And the multi-talented Viva Van is with us. Viva, how are you tonight?
Hi, I'm doing really good, thank you. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. I am doing really well. Thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule. I know you've got a busy schedule, and your time is valuable. We appreciate you taking time out. I really do.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Oh, no problem. In 2014 and 2015, we started highlighting West Coast women's wrestling with wrestlers such as Ruby Reyes, Kikyo, Hudson Envy, Thunder Rosa. All of those ladies have been on this program, and it's actually been a little bit of time, like I said, since we've been or had a West Coast talent on. So I'd like to start off with your thoughts on the current wrestling scene and opportunities in wrestling right now on the West Coast.
My thoughts are that women's wrestling has really exploded in the past few years. And, you know, I just started late last year, and it's been growing, and I feel like it'll keep growing.
Yeah.
And getting a lot of opportunities, yeah.
Yeah, and I know I saw you posted, like, for promotions like AWS and a few others, and we're going to get into those because there's a couple that I'm really fond of. Santino Brothers, cha-ching, is one of those, but we'll get into that in a minute. What is your definition of the term professional wrestling?
The term for professional wrestling is someone who professionally trained for this profession. If you get
right.
what I mean.
I totally get what you mean. There's a reason why the word professional is in front of wrestling, correct?
Exactly, because anyone can try wrestling. Anyone can be a wrestler. But to be a professional wrestler, you actually have to train, go through some training for that.
Yeah, you have to put in the work.
Yeah.
You have to put in the work.
Exactly.
I read a post earlier today. It's funny that we were talk about that. About wrestlers that we're talking about wannabe promoters, not other wannabe wrestlers, but wannabe promoters, you know, stiffing people and all that other stuff. And do you see that more now? I mean, it was a few years ago. We saw a lot of wannabe wrestlers, and I think that kind of got thinned out. Is the wannabe promoter still a thing?
Wannabe promoter as in, like,
basically we
mean?
Get a guy that's the guy that says, man, I want to put on a wrestling show, has no clue about the business, has a little bit of money, enough to rent a building and get some ring, and they set up a few chairs, and then at the end of the night when you hold out your hand to get your pay envelope, there's nothing there. Wannabe promoter.
Well, thankfully I haven't met anyone like that yet.
Okay.
I'm sure I will maybe in the future, but thankfully I haven't came across that. I have heard of it, but haven't personally went through it myself to even say anything about that.
Okay. Well, good. Good for you. Good for you. There's nothing worse than getting stiffed. Nothing worse than that. How did the Hellbent Vixen come to be? I mean, what was it about professional wrestling that made you say, I want to be involved with this? How did that come about?
I've always been a huge fan of wrestling since I was a little girl, you know, and one of my dreams was to be a professional wrestler, but I was always too embarrassed to tell people that.
Okay.
I would always, like, be scared that people would tease me for it for a very long time, and it was just until I was probably in my second year of college is when I was like, do I really want to be an accountant for the rest of my life?
Mm.
So I'm like,
okay.
You know what? I'm going to give it my all, and I looked up, you know, wrestling schools in L.A., and Santino Bros was the first one to pop up. And I actually stalked their IG page for about a whole year before I even started training there.
Right.
Yeah, and no, the whole Hellbent Vixen is just something that just came within time.
Okay. Okay. No, that's cool. You know, and you talked about, you know, people, you know, with the teasing with the, you know, wrestling, and you know, oh, I can't believe you watch that stuff. And just a little bit mm-hmm. older than you, just by a little bit. And I still get that to this day. You know, why do you watch that? You know, that kind of thing. What are people's reactions when you tell them, you know, hey, you know, come see me do my thing at the show. I wrestle a little bit. What's their reaction when you tell them that?
Their reaction is always like, wow, really? Like, what's your IG? Like, right away, they want to, like, look up my social media to see if what I'm saying is true.
Right.
And then once I start telling them more about the show, they're like, oh, yeah, I really want to go. Like, there is usually always positive. There are a few people who, like, laugh
yeah.
at it, you know? The ones that don't know, the ones that don't care about wrestling in general. But
mm-hmm.
the majority of everyone's reaction is always positive and always amazed.
That's cool, because, you know, be still my beating heart, because maybe there's now a shift from that, oh, you that wrestling stuff, you know, to actually, you know, it being cool again, like it was, you know, the Hulk Hogan years. I remember, this is really going to date me. Now you're really going to know how old I am. I can remember when it was cool to watch professional wrestling. Everybody, you know, you had, you know, lunch boxes and t-shirts and toys. And it's not
yeah.
to say that you don't have that today, mm-hmm. but it was mainstream, and I see it coming back around. So, you know, mm-hmm. I think that's cool. That's cool that you're getting that reaction. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. obviously, like we said at the beginning, the last 2 to 3 years have been mm-hmm. pivotal in women's wrestling, and we've celebrated all of the firsts, you know, the quote unquote first, at least at the major televised level, you know, at first
mm-hmm.
all women, first all that other stuff. What needs to happen, Viva, so that the momentum continues forward? Where do we go from here?
I think we just keep continuing what we're doing. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what else that we can do to keep pushing. I feel like it just keeps growing. Like, we're out here now. The more we keep working, the more we keep pushing, the more we believe in ourselves, it'll just continue to keep growing for women's wrestling. That's it.
Just got to keep putting forth.
Now people are aware of it.
Right.
Yeah,
got to keep putting forth. Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense. Quality over quantity, would you say?
Well, that depends.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. What is your opinion of AEW, this new startup promotion that really hasn't had a wrestling show yet, but it has all of the hype as if,
mm-hmm.
you know, the world is going to stop turning once that first bell rings? What are your thoughts on AEW?
I think it's great. It's another place for wrestlers to look forward to working at, or hoping to get the opportunity to work at, you know, more work for all of us if we eventually get there. AEW is a new platform, yet yes, like, they haven't had a show yet and they have all this hype, and I honestly believe that they can back up their hype for sure.
I don't think I have ever seen in my 40 some odd years of watching professional wrestling, a wrestling promotion generates so much buzz, so much
yeah.
fervor, and have not even had a show yet. This is crazy to me. I saw, I saw Cody's promo against his brother coming up against Dustin,
yeah.
and my God, what
that
a promo.
Insane.
I mean, it doesn't get any, I mean, I'm invested in, We're not even there yet. So, I mean,
exactly.
that's got to be part of the big draw, right? Being emotionally
mm-hmm.
invested?
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
Okay. You've had the opportunity to wrestle for several different promotions in various areas. And one of my favorite places to watch matches online comes from Santino Brothers. Tell me about your... Yeah, I mean, the reason why is it has that old school, small, just, you know, small studio, small venue feel. The fans are right there. The energy level is good. I mean, what are your thoughts? What about your experiences there? And what makes that place seem so magical?
You know, Santino Bros, that's my home. They're the ones who took me in. They taught me everything. Joey Chaos and Robbie Phoenix, you know, they everything that I know about wrestling, I've learned from them. And every time I'm there, it's just, every time I wrestle, it's a smaller place to wrestle at, but it feels so good to be there.
Yeah.
You know, you just know that feeling when you're home. It's that magical feeling. You can't explain it, but... And the fans there, they're loyal. They've been going to Santino Bros shows for years, so we always see the same faces over and over again, and we're starting to see new faces now, too.
That's cool. That's cool. I know that Joey puts out a lot of, or a partial, instructional videos on matches. I watched one, matter of fact, 3 or 4 days ago about constructing and deconstructing a basic match, starting with the finish first and working your way backwards and the psychology behind that. Is there something that has really stood out that Joey has taught you or talked to you about that just really, really holds its weight?
Yes, you know, it's kind of hard to explain, but with wrestling, everything is subjective. So whenever you go into something, that's one thing that Joey always tells me. Like, yeah, we have something to follow. Like, we have to follow the structure of a match, like you have mentioned. Like, we start from the finisher and then we go backwards. That's something I take with me. But when I meet new people that are trained from different locations, I can't just always stick to, you know, to what I know. I have to eventually, like, how do I explain that? I have to, like, be subjective. There's no other word for it. And like use the training that I know and incorporate it with the training that the other person knows as well. You get me? So that's one thing that Joey has always told me. He thought, take everything in, soak everything in from every wrestler you've ever worked with, because you will learn something new from everyone.
There was a professional wrestler there, and I hope that I get this name right because I'm going from memory. I didn't even scratch this down. Tyler Bateman, is that correct?
Correct, yes.
He's an evil man, isn't he? An evil man.
No, he's a very nice guy.
Oh, he's a nice guy. Okay, well, don't tell him. We can't tell him. We gotta know he's a bad guy, folks. No, I've seen videos with him and Ruby Reyes and stuff, and he just exudes everything that you want in a bad character, quote-unquote heel character. He's a bad, evil guy. Bad, evil guy. Terrible individual.
Yes,
If you guys don't know what we're talking about, if you're not in with what's going on at Santino Brothers, please make sure that you check them out on all forms of social media. It's not hard, folks. You're on there every day working your thumbs. All you got to do is Google Santino Brothers, and you can find everything that you need to know. Check out what we're talking about, especially on YouTube. You guys are doing yourself a disservice if you're not watching what's going on with Santino Brothers. You are a published model and are very photogenic. Now, some would argue that it's just quote-unquote modeling. Now, what would you say to someone to sway their opinion of its quote-unquote just modeling?
It wouldn't be just modeling. The reason why I have published model is because I've actually been published in magazines. That's the difference. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Modeling can just be modeling. You can take, nowadays you can take pictures and edit it on your phone and just post it online. It's not as special as how it used to be like 5 years back. Like, I don't even think people read magazines anymore.
Yeah, it's tough, but I mean, there are it is still popular. I mean, people, there's still a call for it.
Yeah, exactly. But to people who say modeling is just modeling, I don't pay no mind to that. It doesn't offend me or anything.
Okay. is modeling a vehicle that you would like to use or that you have used going into acting, per se?
I did used to do acting. I've actually stopped acting. I did it back in 2011.
Okay.
Did a lot of extra work, and that was before my modeling, actually.
Okay. Okay.
So I have everything all backwards.
Okay. All right. That's fair enough. Well, something else that may be backwards, but I gotta talk about it because I saw a video that you posted some time ago of you singing as the lead vocalist in a death metal band. Are you still singing, Viva?
I am trying to. I haven't. That was my old band from back in the day, Mocking of the Trinity, and I'm trying to start like a small recording project, but it's in the works. So yes, I still am.
Okay, so it's top secret. We can't talk about it. Okay.
Well, I have, yeah, exactly, something like that.
Okay. All right. Okay, that's cool. Who right now should we check out? You know, because this is kind of crazy because I've listened to all kinds of music. I've listened to, you know, rock, heavy metal, death metal, thrash, pop, R&B, all that good stuff. I've listened to a lot. And I just recently discovered a band called Ginger and a band called Arch Enemy. I don't know. Call me dumb, but I, you know, YouTube's a thing, right? Who are you familiar with those bands? You familiar with them?
I'm familiar with Arch Enemy.
Okay.
Huh?
Okay.
What was your question? Your last one?
Who else should I be checking out?
Oh, you should be listening to the old school stuff, the stuff that's not as popular.
Oh, okay. So that's like mainstream, right?
Yeah. I mean, okay. I like Arch Enemy, though. I like Arch Enemy.
Okay.
I do listen to Arch Enemy sometimes. But the type of metal that I listen to is very old school and not as popular. But check out Necrophobic, Unleashed.
Cannibal Corpse.
Of course, Cannibal Corpse. You got to throw that
Storm
in.
Stormtroopers of Death.
Dissection.
Yeah. Okay. Obituary.
Yeah, those are my kind of bands. Obituary.
Okay.
Of course. Yes. Yes.
See?
You know.
See,
we're not
that far removed. I've got an idea or two of what you're talking about. I got an idea about that. What is the one thing that you think surprises wrestling fans the most when they have the opportunity to meet you? What catches them off guard about you?
I think the whole death metal being in a death metal band or being into death metal in general, fans seem to like relate to me more because of it.
Okay.
Like I've met fans and they'll see my shirt and they're like, oh, I listen to this band as well. Or if I see someone wearing a cool shirt, I'll, you know, tell them nice shirt as well. And we'll start talking about that band. So that's what's been really cool meeting fans.
Isn't it kind of ironic that there's always like that tie together, because I've heard the same thing about wrestling and anime or wrestling and cosplay, wrestling and say, for example, like ICP, that there just seems to be this thing with professional wrestling that fans can get together and not be judgmental or not as judgmental of one another. You know what I mean?
Yes, correct.
And you find find that same thing in different things, like in music and cosplay. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
Okay. All right. the other co-host of the program, Laura, she couldn't be with us tonight. She had something that was going on.
Aww.
She was doing a thing. But she sent me this. She sent me a question and said that I had to ask. And I said, okay, I'll ask this. I guess she saw some picture of you, and it said in your question was, your R2-D2 luggage is awesome. Where did you get it from?
Oh, wow. That's a really old post. Okay, I got my R2-D2 bag in downtown Disney. I think they should still sell it, right? I mean,
I would think.
Come on.
Yeah,
that's,
I mean, it's R2-D2, it's Star Wars.
It should never go away.
Yeah, That's a money mine. You just
Store
people just
for sure. Yeah, I bought it in downtown Disney, so That's where I got
down,
it.
Okay, so if you're interested in R2-D2 luggage, you might be able to go to Disney.com, cha-ching, and you know, maybe
you
be
go.
Able to find an R2-D2 tote along or something. So that's cool. You know, we're huge fans of goal lists on this show, you know, because everybody has to set goals. So tell me, what are some of the goals that you would like to reach in 2019?
I am definitely, my top goal is to win SoCal Rookie of the Year.
Really? Okay, SoCal Rookie of the
yes.
Year.
Yes.
When does that voting, or when does that start to take place? Is that going to happen, obviously, later on at the end of the year? Is that correct?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
Either
is that,
the end of the year or early next year, around that time.
Okay. Is that put on by one particular promotion, or is that voted on by just the fans, or how's that work?
It's put on by SoCal Uncensored. Have you heard
okay.
of them?
I have heard of them.
Yeah. Yeah. They're the ones who have those awards going every year. And so far, Santino Bros, we've been winning Rookie of the Year for the past, I think, five to 6 years or so.
Okay. Right. Okay.
And I would like to do that for Santino Bros.
Okay. No, that's cool. That's cool. What do you want fans to know when they see the name Viva Van on the wrestling card? What is it that they can expect from you?
What I want them to expect from me is that I'm a very hardworking wrestler. I put in the work, and I hope that they'll enjoy everything that I do and everything that's to come.
That's pretty cool. Pretty cool. That's pretty awesome. What ultimately is the goal for you, Viva? We're wanting to get to NXT. We're wanting to get to Impact. We're wanting to get to AEW. What's ultimately is your dream?
Everything you just named. I want to be everywhere. I want to travel the world. And you've named every single promotion that I want to work for.
Okay. Well, I think you can only work for them one at a time. There's not a multi-promotional contract that I'm aware of.
Well, you get what I mean. I'm just thinking. My fan of my whole life, I want to be able to work for each promotion for a certain amount.
That's cool.
You know?
That's
you get
cool.
what I mean.
You know what you mean, and that's awesome.
That, you know?
Sounds good to me. Where are you going to be at coming up, Viva? If fans want to come out and see you, where are you going to be wrestling at coming up?
I will be wrestling for Mass Republic this coming Sunday, actually.
Okay. Where is that show going to be held at? As least far as the town is concerned.
It's going to be held in Hollywood. Hold on. I'm pulling up the flyer right now.
Okay.
At Madame Tussin's.
Okay.
Or I probably pronounced that so wrong, but that's the name of the venue, and it's in Hollywood.
Okay. All right.
For fans,
okay.
you guys need to go down to Mass Republic's Instagram and Facebook page, and you guys will see the flyer, because I'm probably pronouncing that all wrong.
That's okay. Laura would attest that I mispronounce things wrong all the time. So yeah, that's not a problem. We're all good with that. For merchandise, do you have a pro wrestling tee store or a way for fans to get a hold of merchandise? Obviously, maybe at a show you have 8x10s, but any other avenues for merchandise?
I will have 8x10s this Sunday at the show I'm wrestling at. And as for shirts, I'm still working on that. One of my sponsors is creating my own little website, so I'll have a link out for people to just order shirts through there. I'll see how that goes, and I will promote it on all social media platforms.
Okay. All right. See how that goes, folks. You get sponsorship, and you get your own website, you get your own shirt, and you know, and you start selling merchandise, and then the money comes rolling in. For fans that want to connect with you on social media, how can they do that?
You guys can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at VivaVanOfficial. And on Facebook, just type in Viva Van and you'll find me there.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Viva, thank you so much again for taking time out of your schedule to come on the show tonight. Had an awesome time speaking with you, getting to know you, and I certainly wish you nothing but the best of luck in the upcoming future.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome.
Hey, everybody. This is Lola Laura. Did you know that Bob thinks the saying goes, a cupcake a day will keep the doctor away?
It does. It does. And folks, you know what doesn't stay away is top rope belts and turnbuckle cupcakes from this program. That program being live from the Armory Wrestling Show. You've heard Laura and I talk about top rope belts, turnbuckle cupcakes for the last 5 years. Make sure that you're supporting your local independent wrestling business that supports the biz-nez, if you get what we're saying. www.topropebelts.com. Go to www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com. Make sure you're supporting your local independent wrestling businesses. What do you think, Laura?
Have you heard about the one?
Yeah, the one about the cupcakes, yeah.
Had a lot of fun getting to talk and get to know Viva. Very, very nice young lady. And again, out of the Santino Bros Wrestling Academy in Los Angeles. So make sure that if you're not following Santino Bros and you're not familiar with what's going on the West Coast, remember, it wasn't that long ago there was a bumper crop, so to speak, of extremely talented ladies that made their way out of the West Coast scene around the world and around the United States. And people were like, man, where did these ladies come from? Well, they came from the West Coast. So make sure you're checking out Santino Bros and make sure you're checking out Viva Van on all social media platforms. What'd you think?
I liked her. I liked her a lot. She had a very bubbly personality and, had that R2-D2. Downtown Disney, for those that don't know, it's kind of like the adult area of Disney. It's like, where you would go if you didn't have any kids, if you wanted to, drop the kids off with someone that night and go down. There's a lot of bars and nightclubs and things like that down there. And they've got a lot of great shops, too. So I see a Disney World trip in my and John's future. At some point, especially when they open up the new Star Wars.
Very, very, very cool young lady, and certainly wish her nothing but the best, and hopefully she will get that SoCal Rookie of the Year moniker, and make sure that you're checking. Yeah, exactly. So, and I didn't know that until she actually said it in the interview that Santino Bros had a wrestler from their school be SoCal Rookie of the Year the last 4 or 5 years in a row. So want to definitely
great.
Make sure. Yeah. Make sure that you're checking those out. There's a few things on the agenda tonight that I wanted to run down because the good doctor took the week off. We don't have our installment of the kayfabe couch. He had to take a stress holiday, a staycation, so to speak. I saw a really, I don't know how to put this. I saw very interesting match clips, and I actually messaged this young lady to see if the full match had been put up. Savannah Summers, who some of you may know or may not know, is an Australian-based wrestler, a very, very talented wrestler, who has worked with the likes of Rhea Ripley and a ton of other people. She could be considered, she is women's wrestling when it comes to Australia. She had a match against a lady named Mickey Fortune for Riot City Wrestling in a street fight. I don't know if you've seen any clips from this fight or have seen clips from this match, but there's There's one point in this match where Savannah powerbombs Mickey onto a thing of thumbtacks in the ring. And I have seen a lot of powerbombs. And I'm telling you what, I don't know how it is she didn't drive this girl through the mat all the way to the floor. I mean, it is vicious, absolutely vicious. And I'm hoping that either Riot City or Savannah or somebody that was in attendance to that show, I believe it was in South Adelaide, if I'm correct. I'm hoping somebody puts this whole match up. So if you're not, if you don't know what I'm talking about, all you got to do is search Savannah Summers on Facebook or on social media. It'd be very easy. Wrestler based out of Australia. Check out those clips that I'm talking about. Brutal, 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 brutal. Speaking of brutal, I want to talk about one of your favorite wrestlers, the Beast, Brock Lesnar.
Shit.
What are you shitting for? Why is that?
Brock Lesnar.
You don't like Brock Lesnar?
What do you think?
Well, I can tell by your silence that you don't, this next segment is not going to scratch you one way or the other. So it was announced earlier today, between yesterday and today, that Brock Lesnar has told Dana White that he is officially retired from the UFC. You remember there was a big buildup about Brock Lesnar coming back to UFC to fight Daniel Cormier. And everybody's like, what does this got to do with wrestling? Well, here's the deal. A lot of people feel that the reason why Lesnar retired from UFC is that he's going to strike another deal or is in talks with WWE about coming back and potentially wrestling a retirement match at WrestleMania 37 for the WWE. And here's what I think about that. When you had Paul Heyman out there hyping up the Beast as being the two-sport athlete, he's going to walk out of the WWE, take the WWE Universal title, walk it into UFC, fight Daniel Cormier, become the modern-day two-sport title-holding champion, all that. All that is a wash now. So what is it that you're going to build Brock Lesnar as to be, a quitter in UFC or retire? You know, he's retired, doesn't have it anymore. I really don't know what the angle is coming back. And I, to be honest with you, I don't know if the fans can really stomach another Brock Lesnar run. I really just don't know.
I sure can't, because here's the thing is that, you know, in order for Seth to beat him, he had to, you know, kick him in the nards.
He low blowed him. And, but I mean, how could you possibly write an angle in for Brock Lesnar to have a lengthy run, you know, because, you know, the part-time deal is gone. The training for UFC is gone. I mean, where does that leave it? It just leaves it out in limbo. So if Lesnar were to return, I don't know how well it would be received, especially after, like what you said, fans have had their belly full of him for a year. I don't see it.
It doesn't matter, because the WWE will fight it. Because did you see the shit show that was Raw?
No, usually the week after Mania, I stop. That's it for me.
Well, yeah, that's what I should have said. None for me, thanks. I'm driving. Because it did not make one lick of sense. So I'm like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
And I fell asleep through most of it. But, yeah, it's just – I listened to Dave LaGreca and Bully Ray talk about this on Twisted Open. And they came up with some great stuff, and I won't go into it, but they, you know, Dave LaGreca's like, I'm mad as hell and not going to take it anymore, because we're tired of this shit not making any sense.
Yeah.
But they'll make it make sense. I assure you. And the thing about, you know, and I get people are like, oh, he brings eyes to the product, and yeah, he does. But what will he do now that he's not going to be, you know, returning to USC for sure? Because I think there was always that specter of that, you know, hanging over him.
Sure.
Is he going to go?
Sure.
But now you've got none of that, and you know, it's bad enough that that the WWE have made these iconic, I don't want to say lower, but I don't want to say junior, but, you know, iconic championships like the U.S. title and the Intercontinental title to mean nothing nowadays. And now, you know, and the Universal title meant nothing because your champ, and I get the whole, we've talked about that, you know, not he doesn't have to be on TV every week. Well, he's got to be on TV at least once a freaking month. I mean, come on.
Well, yeah, I mean, now that takes that away from him now. I mean, he can't, you know, he can't say, well, you know, he's off training because he's going back to UFC, this, that, and the other. Everybody knows Brock Lesnar is a very private guy. He likes his space. You know, is he a guy that's going to now go full-time on the road? You know, want to be on Raw every Monday night or on SmackDown every whatever? Or do we save Lesnar for the launch of Fox? Now, that could be a possibility. We're not going to rule that out. You want big names for big draws, you know, because the WWE's, I saw the ratings again and again. I don't put a lot of stock in ratings anymore. And it seems like all these other quote unquote information sites want to hammer on the WWE's ratings. And my thought on it is that with so many avenues to be able to watch stuff and the attention span of today's wrestling fan, I don't know of a lot of people that are going to sit on their couch, in their chair for 3 hours on Monday night for the entirety of the show. It's just not, it is not like it was in yesterday. It's just not there. When you can, you know, watch, you know, the WWE is very social media heavy. You can watch matches. You can watch clips. You can watch highlights. I think a lot of times fans are content with catching highlights until there's something that really piques their interest. They tune in for a match, and then they tune out.
Well, I can tell you what concrete numbers are. You know, the rating system is kind of iffy because, you know, people watch these things on multiple platforms. What isn't shaky or could be shaky is the fact that the WWE lost millions of dollars last quarter.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. So that hammers home to me. Yeah, well, I don't think that there's a bleed out. And I mean, they're very forthcoming because they're a publicly traded company now. You have conference calls where they address the stockholders. Anybody can listen in to the conference call, the quarterly reports, and they will tell you the exact earnings, you know, what the forecast is for the next quarter, you know, all that other stuff. They give answers as to why.
Right. But yeah, that has to factor into that because you went from a company that was making money hand over fist at one point. And
right.
I think what it boils down to, and I don't want to harp on the WWE, I think it boils down to is that continuity.
Yeah.
I can follow a crazy ass storyline as long as it's continuing.
As long as it's continually crazy.
Right. And it makes sense. It just, you know, when you've got, they brought up this point. Okay, so Bobby Roode hands Ricochet his first defeat on TV that we've seen.
Okay.
That the casual fan have seen. I mean, he got beaten in NXT, of course. But he did that last week. So who is not on Raw this week? Bobby Roode.
Yeah.
Who is in place in this Money in the Bank match? Ricochet.
Yeah.
That makes any sense. What's crap?
WWE hoping that the buy rate goes up because they want to see Ricochet do a 450 off the ladder.
I think it's a great idea to put him in that Money in the Bank match, but why'd you have him lose the week before? And then Zully was like, well, maybe they kept Bobby Roode off TV so that you wouldn't remember that he lost. So it would look better that Ricochet's. And I'm like, no, because Ricochet actually looked like, I mean, compared to the rest of the people that were in that ring, I mean, you know, I'm not taking away from Ricochet, but I mean, this shit doesn't make any sense. It makes no sense.
It's professional wrestling. Sometimes it doesn't make sense.
But it should at least be continuously not making sense. The broken gimmick was great, but it was continuous. I mean, it was kind of here, there, and everywhere, but, you know, Matt was still broken. You know what I mean? It just, you know, it just went from, but anyway, I don't want to harp on.
The only thing I can tell you is tune in next Monday night and see if it's continually dumb. That's the only thing I can tell you.
Well, I'll be sleeping.
Okay. Another thing that kind of came out about on Twitter today was the artist formerly known as Dean Ambrose returning with his John Moxley name, and a video that's been circulating around. And I've watched this video a couple times, and I'm going to tell you three things. Number one, for somebody that was leaving or is leaving or has left the WWE, and I put this out on social media, for somebody that is leaving or has left or whatever, man, they sure did spend a lot of time patting him on the back as he was going out the door. I mean, we had, you know, the Shield reunion. We had WWE.com exclusive videos. We walked, you know, to the ring as the Shield. They had an after special. I mean, I've never seen anybody that has not signed an extension on their contract be shown the door so gracefully in my tenure in watching professional wrestling. I can never remember it. They might actually even open up the Dean Ambrose memorial wing to the Hall of Fame at someday.
Person that I can think of that was anything remotely like that is when Bobby the Brain Heenan left. Because Gorilla Monsoon threw him out.
Yeah. All right.
That's
so
the only thing I can think of. So, and I've got a comment about that as well. So.
Okay. All right. So number two, the video is not shot by, you know, Stevie down the street. Okay.
Right.
You can tell that this video is professionally done. You can tell that it has a budget. It is not something that just say Joe Blow down the street, right? Did okay? This was pro shot, slick production with a budget, and probably more money than just say one individual would want to put forth as a release video announcing their quote-unquote independence. We'll just put it like that. And the third thing that stood out to me about this video, I'm kind of in a quandary over this one. At the very end, it shows him holding, you know, a bunch of barbed wire in his hand and squeezing it, and we've got blood running down the arm and all that other stuff. And I'm kind of like, let's think about this for just a minute. How is it plausible? How is it possible that let's just say, for example, that the WWE would allow that to be used as somebody's entrance video, or would allow that to be used as a repackaging video, a vignette? Not very likely at all. I mean, I watched a video today, some highlights from NXT UK, between Walter and, was it Ace Devlin? Is that his name?
I think so, yeah.
Just a brutal chop. And it would appear that somebody got nicked on the cheek or something, but there was some blood. And, of course, automatically we went from color to black and white video. So, I find it ironic, you know, that people are saying, well, I wonder if that's the WWE repackaging Dean Ambrose as John Moxley. And I'm like, I'm not so sold on that. So I'm kind of in a quandary over this, but I want to hear your thoughts.
Well, I'm in the quandary too, but I got this thing in today on the way back from Charlotte.
Yeah.
Because I'm thinking about this video and the way it looks and the way it's packaged. And the first thing that came to mind was, no one said that video doesn't say anything about John Moxley. It says something about Mox.
Yeah, Mox. Yeah.
So, and that led me to believe, that led me to start thinking, well, what if the WWE just repackages him as just Mox? to bring in this kind of what they were doing with him before. It's kind of like this stone, this new Stone Cold figure, the second coming of Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Yeah.
And then I got to thinking about the same thing about that barbed wire. I'm like, I don't know if WWE, but what if Dean Ambrose, well, formerly known as Dean Ambrose, what if this Mox character is the person that brings, that takes WWE from the PG era to the PG-13 era? We're not going quite full-on attitude.
That's true.
But what if we're a little edgier? What if a publicly traded company could be a little bit edgier? Now, mind you, barbed wire, and I've talked to John about this. I'm like, you know, if I'm wrong, I will say I'm wrong, but I still think it's the swerve. I smell swerve. And if I'm wrong about it, I'll be the first person to say I was wrong about that. But that's the only thing that really kept me from thinking, is this really a swerve? Because what's the barbed wire and he's bleeding? But what if? What if?
Well, you know, it's funny that you should
could bring that.
Well, it's funny you should mention that. The WWE has been flirting with a little more language. You know, some things like that. So it wouldn't surprise me. It wouldn't surprise me that if it isn't a swerve, it wouldn't surprise me that that he is still with the WWE. And when I had alluded to with Brock Lesnar, you know, and the Fox launch, it could be one of those things where, you know, they
with
could
Fox,
hold it.
Maybe, yeah.
They could hold him, you know, give him some time off, let him do his own thing, you know, for a little while, and then you bring him in during the Fox launch. Here's the thing, though. That's quite a few months away. That's a long time to be off TV. It's a long time to get, you know, that, you know, coming in cold. I would think that you would rather want to strike when the momentum was hot, see what kind of buzz this generates. But my initial thoughts is that he has not departed from the WWE. Ladies and gentlemen, he is still very much under contract or signed a contract extension with WWE. The WWE would have not put forth the time, effort, talent, money, or production on giving this guy any more than a pat on the back and handing him his bag as they walked him out the door through catering during his last scheduled appearance.
Yeah, the,
they let this guy come out after they went off air, for God's sakes. Come on, let's get real.
There's something fishy about this whole thing.
Yeah.
I think old George, I got the tag rope cold from talk.
No, I don't want him to tag in. What? George Coles. Yes, Mr. Coles, you're chiming in with some hot piece of information.
Well, I wanted to break this down because, as you said, you've watched it a few times. And I've watched it a few times. I've read a few write-ups to see if I could see what also people were talking about. Now, you mentioned that one company that could spend the money on making that promo, but you didn't
mention
the other million-dollar companies that could as well. You know, this could easily be done by Sinclair Broadcasting.
Certainly
could be. This could easily been done by, say, someone that owns two sports teams that know how to make promotional videos.
That's true.
This could have been done by Billy Corgan, who is a fantastic visual artist.
That is true as well.
Here's the few things that I picked up on and other people have picked up on from the video. In the beginning of the video, they show scratches on the wall like, you know, you would see in a normal prison.
Right.
And the scratches add up to 25. Now, why is that important? What
because
day
it's
is
May 25th. May 25th, Mr. Coles.
And also there's dice that are shown that are on 2 and 5 as well. And what do you think? When you think dice, you think Vegas, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Now,
roll one for the pole one.
Now, could this all be, you know, a MacGuffin to throw us off the scent to get people looking in the wrong direction, misdirection? Of course it could.
Sure.
But I think there was a lot of really good symbolism. Him breaking out of prison or the asylum,
right.
Leaving the Ambrose Asylum behind.
Sure.
Running away from the big dog.
Yeah, the big dog.
Reigns, who's the guy,
yeah.
The guy that was pushed when, you guys remember, when the Shield was first put together, it was supposed to be a package to bring Dean Ambrose or Jon Moxley as the next big star. It wasn't to be Roman Reigns to be the next big star. And
okay.
Maybe that's the thing, that he felt overshadowed and he felt like the WWE did him wrong. Now, the one thing that I wanted to mention, and the most important reason why I wanted to call in, I've seen a ton of reports that, unlike other contracts with the no-compete clauses, his contract is over, period. He wants to show up on Impact Wrestling tonight. He could be on Impact Wrestling on their TV tonight with no-compete. Everything's done. He's legal to show up anywhere he wants to.
Okay, so here's
but
the thought
I have one
then.
Problem with that, though. I have one problem
yeah.
with that. Is that if they pull Kurt Angle from just doing mm-hmm. WrestleCade because they supposedly are aligned with AEW, why would they send him off the way they have, knowing that he could be going to AEW? That's what
that's
the thing that doesn't make sense to me.
Well, that's the thing I was going to chime in with. The only thing I can think of, and you back me up on this, George, if you want to. The only thing that I can think of is that perhaps there was a last-minute deal on the table, and they were hoping beyond hope that he was going to either pen the deal or he had a handshake deal in place. And, you know, they had already shot this footage thinking that all the way up until the very end that he was going to resign, and he didn't. That would be the only plausible explanation mm-hmm. that I could come up with, that you would want to spend that much effort and time on a talent leaving.
Well, I'll buy that.
I could tell you that WWE is, I don't want to say they're pushing panic buttons over AEW, but they're handling things a whole lot differently than they would have in the past.
Yeah.
They're
right.
not releasing wrestlers when they're asking for contract releases where,
sure.
you know, 5 years ago they would have. They're
right.
not. They're being very careful on who they sign and how much they sign them for and what they run into the contract.
Mm-hmm.
There's two ways to look at it. I'm in the same theory that both of you are, that this is all a thing to bring him back to TV because you can't, or bring him back to WWE TV because it's never been done before like this. It's no one's got this great of a send off like you both have said. Even the only thing, like Laura said, with Heenan and maybe Bret Hart, because it was well known that Bret Hart was leaving, but even then, we've seen how that ended.
Not good.
Here's the thing, too, is that, you know, beforehand, when the WWF was going toe-to-toe with WCW, it was right up front, in your face, and we had a lot of old-school people that were behind the scenes that knew of no other way other than that right up in your face type thing, Vince McMahon leading the charge. Now you have some people that are younger, that are more savvy to social media, more savvy to social media marketing, some younger minds, some more forward thinking people that say, hey, you know, we can do the same thing, but what if we went about this, you know? And I think that that's what it's going to take. The only way to circle the wagons around savvy promotion and the social media blitz that AEW is currently putting out is to counteract that with the same type of marketing, but only just a little bit smarter, just a little bit. And I think that's what might be going on.
And you could be 100% right, Bob. I just want to chime in and add a little bit of the seasoning. You guys are the steak, of course, and I'm just the garland that goes on top.
Oh, so brother.
Put a little bit of that seasoning in there while you guys are still
talking. George.
Yeah, you're a parsley. Well, you're a snip of parsley, George.
Well, I'll take Farsi over A1 because A1 can ruin a good steak. It can make a terrible steak edible, but it can also.
George can't take a compliment cold.
That's what it is. That's
George,
what it is.
No sale cold.
Yep. George Heinz 57 coals. Yeah.
I appreciate it. But I just wanted to chime in, add a little bit. Fantastic interview you did there, Bob. Definitely. And
thank
Laura,
you.
You're always great hearing your voice.
Well, I appreciate that, George.
Yeah. Thank you, George.
Thank you, guys.
There he goes. Oh, he's just pandering to the masses now. Now it's all just kids play.
I'm with you. Huh? I just want to say real quick, I'm with you. I really think that something is rotten in the state of Denmark because all this just doesn't add up at all.
It adds up, but it adds up in a crazy way. We'll put it that way. We'll see. That's the fun part of this, doing this, is speculating. And George had mentioned it already. You know, we've already mentioned it 3 or 4 times during this broadcast. We're finally into the month of May, and other than Women's Wrestling Month, it is also the countdown to AEW, finally. In 24 days, all the speculation will be put to rest, and
we're going to see if this is more than a t-shirt company.
We're going to see if this is more than a super indie show. We'll put it that way. We shall see. May the 25th. We got 24 days, 24 days and counting. So want to go on and announce next week's guest, and some people are going to be confused by this, and we're not trying to pull a swerve on you. This is Women's Wrestling Month, but next week joining us will be Zane Riley. And everybody's like, what is there, you know, something that we don't know about? Was there a procedure or surgery done? No, there's none of that. What some people may not realize is that other than being an accomplished wrestler himself, Zane also works behind the scenes, and he works behind the scenes at one of the hottest all-women's wrestling promotions in the United States at Queens of Combat. And we're going to talk to Zane about what it takes to run a successful all-women's wrestling promotion, the thought process on booking, on character development, on storylines. We're actually going to go behind the scenes with Zane next week, and we're going to find out what it takes to make an all-women's wrestling card and carry that forward from just a one-off show into what Queens of Combat has done now.
First of all, you got to have women. You got to have all women. I can tell you that much.
Yeah, yes, it has to be. Yeah, it can be. Yeah, except for him. He can be there. So.
Although I did see, you know, Joey Ryan wrestle on the Queens of Combat show with Candice LeRae taking on the Lucha Sisters.
Well, that'd be one of the questions. When is it prosperous? When is it good to bring
when
in
is it best
a
for business, Bob?
Yeah, yes, for a male wrestler to appear in an all women's promotion. I mean, we can only do the Andy Kaufman routine
that.
So many times. Yes, he does. He's very active in it. So.
Yeah.
So we will talk with Zane Riley about Queens of Combat next week on this program. Do you have anything else that you would like to add?
Well, I would just like to say that I'm sorry I couldn't do the interview with you yesterday. I missed out on that one. But stick around. We've got some great guests coming up in the month of May, and we're booking for June now. So anybody got a... someone they'd like to see on our show, shoot us an email or tweet us or leave us a Facebook comment, and we'll see what we can do.
Absolutely. Folks, we thank you for listening to this episode of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. We're heard here every week on Blog Talk Radio and on every other major podcast platform. We thank you so much for your support. We'll be back here next Wednesday night. We hope that you enjoy your week. Be safe. And remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Thanks for listening.
Whoop, whoop.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week. We'll